Welcome to our CGA film stage. It's time to go from rookies to some real business and talk about the transformation and what it means remodeling the success in our today industry. You might have noticed that we have some recurring and returning speakers to CGA this year, which is the best reason why we want to keep our community close together and follow their growth and transformation. So our next speaker is an expert on transformation and change, and he comes from Berlin, an amazingly creative studio called Woodblock. He's Ilija Brunck, and he's co-owner and our former speaker from CGA 2018. Hi, Ilija. Welcome to our Transform CGA. How are you?
Hi, Melissa. How are you doing? I'm very well. It's like summer is almost over here in Berlin. But so we are enjoying the last days of that. And a little bit sad that I can't make it in person to Belgrade this year. But at least you are like putting all this beautifully together so we can share our thoughts online. Thanks for that.
Yes, this is our CGA matrix, how we like to call it this year. Before we go into your presentation and without spoiling too much, I just wanted to ask you about your personal feeling or your personal idea of the transformation, because you recently rebranded the studio, you also moved spaces. So what's your deal with transformation? Do you find it something hard to take or something very natural?
Yeah, that's a very good question, and also kind of the core topic of the things we're going to talk about in a bit. And it is indeed, as you say, I think it's quite natural to the human mind to be scared of change, which transformation is change in a way, right? Just another word for it. And it is something that for me personally, and also for our studio, is very important to be open-hearted towards change and embrace change, because and not be scared of it, because we think through change we grow, we can become a better version of ourselves. So yeah, it's exactly that. That's why we are trying to embrace change as much as we can.
Yeah, your previous talk also was about how you grew the studio, and now this transformation is going on. So I think we are quite ready to hear what's the next thing that you're embark on, and hear your two cents on the topic.
Wonderful. So let's dive right in. Okay, perfect. So yeah, hi again, everybody. Thanks so much for joining this online. As Melissa said, we have been in Belgrade 2018, and we already talked a little bit about how our studio developed. I'm still gonna sum things up once more again, so to show a bit of the whole journey. And so yeah, the topic of what we're gonna talk about today is transformation. So this is kind of, as Melissa said, when we rebranded our studio in the last couple of months ago, this is kind of something we found is very much at the center of what we are doing, is that kind of everything we do seems to be constantly evolving, constantly changing, and constantly transforming. So that's something that... It's a topic we enjoy talking about, and it's also fascinating because I talk to a lot of studio owners in the world, like from big studios, small studios, and it's something I enjoy a lot. And it's super interesting that there seems to be a lot of parallels in how an animation studio or a creative studio develops. And I think that's why we like to share those thoughts. So maybe it helps some of you who want to start an animation studio to not kind of make the same mistakes we did, maybe learn a couple of things from it, maybe take a couple of shortcuts. Yeah, because as I said, there seem to be many, many similarities in how a studio develops. So before we dive into that, just a couple of words about who we are. So, yeah, the name of our studio is Woodblock. These days we are around 50 on staff, artists, producers, engineers. We normally have like another 10 to 20 freelancers around. We have two studio locations. Our headquarter is in Berlin and our second studio is in Ludwigsburg, and which is also where we studied originally. That's why we still have a studio there, because a couple of us wanted to stay in the beautiful town of Ludwigsburg. And then these days we have a couple of outposts in Copenhagen, in LA, in Munich. This is like something that the pandemic made very possible in a way, with now remote work is the standard, right? We are full on hybrid. People can come into the studio or work remote however they prefer in a way. So this makes it very possible to have a couple of small outposts all over the world. And yeah, we basically, in the past, that's also part of the transformation. Like we looked at our studios like a little bit separate, right? We did like our projects in Berlin. The guys did their projects in Ludwigsburg. But this is something that we also heavily changed. We now see ourselves completely as one team. We work on projects together, and it's a much, much better way of us for working. And yeah, I mean, one thing that we as a studio are particularly proud of, and also think like makes us a bit unique in the space, is that we have no kind of signature style or house style. As we all know, like there's a couple, or there's many studios out there like that have one style they're really amazing in, and you know, if you go to this studio, then you will get that style. We have from the very beginning always been super proud about like the all the different styles we can do, and that's something that we never want to lose, because it keeps the work so much fun. So maybe to give a bit more perspective on the work we do, let's have a look at the reel, at our house reel, and then dive right into it. So I quickly play that back here. So far for that. Maybe just a quick anecdote, because I was just thinking about this, like many of those shots in the reel, right? Like a lot of, I guess, Serbian artists worked on it, because I guess as most of you know, like we are very close with the gang from Dat, Ivan and his amazing crew. And we are working so closely with them, right? That I can see such a big percentage of those shots is somewhere some assets or shots have been touched by Ivan and his crew. So I think that's why it's also obviously the reason why there's this strong connection between us and you guys, right? So, okay, cool. As I already said, like we talked a lot about our history back in 2018, but let's still recap a little bit for everybody who has not been part of that talk or has been able to hear the talk in 2018. So just a little bit about our beginnings. So we at Woodblock, we are a group of six founders. As you can see in the photo below, the seventh one, my son, who is now like almost turning 13 years old. And yeah, we all met studying animation at Film Academy. And it Yeah, it was a wonderful time back then because basically Film Academy gave us all resources we needed to just focus on creating animated short films all day long, all year long, and this is what we did. We like on the left you can see like the two snails, the two robotic snails. This is like the first short film we made, which actually led to the founding of our first label, which we called Polynoid, which we still actively use these days. And the film on the right, Loom, was actually our diploma film, which we finished in 2010. And yeah, with both of those films, like we've been super lucky and happy that we made quite a bit of an impact with them. We won a lot of amazing festivals, including Best of Show, Best in Show at SIGGRAPH, and the VES Award. And so it kind of was the beginning of our career in a way, right? And what was the thing is, like, as many of you probably listening in are students, I guess, one thing that we've always been lucky is that we also, while studying, we started earning money together. So we never had to work like in other jobs, like where we studied. We always made our money creating animation, and many of the projects we did together. And that's kind of how it also happened that we just saved up a little bit of money and started right after our school, started our proper studio. And back in the days, it was still called Polynoid. And we started with big ambitions after the short films we made, after the success it was. And we also started with big hopes. And we had very good connections back in the days to a couple of amazing production companies. PSYOP started repping us through their production company Blacklist. Passion Pictures started representing us. And they kind of, both of them, PSYOP and Passion Pictures, are very active in the commercial space, right? This is what they do. They're in the business of commercials. And, I mean, they also diversify and transformed these days, right? But back in 2010, it was still their main business to actually do commercials. And they, yeah, kind of pulled us into that road strongly, and we thought, okay, cool, why not? I mean, we don't know how to make money with short films. We need to make some money. We need to make a living, right? So let's go down this commercial route. And it had its challenges, of course. It needed a long time until we won our first big pitch. The whole pitching game we had to learn. So this was one of the things we mastered back in those days. And we worked on a lot of shitty projects in the beginning, but then, yeah, when we got better and better at pitching and when we got a bit more of a name, like we started working on better and bigger projects. And we thought like this is a good way to go, but interestingly, it didn't really make us happy. Like we discovered just to recap a little bit more, so we finished studying in 2010, and when we started working on all those commercials, like we already found out, like, as if you remember, we've still been called Polynoid back in the days, but we kind of saw like, okay, cool, what was strange with all this commercial work we're doing is kind of like our Polynoid brand is kind of not clean anymore, right? Because this Polynoid style was always dark and a little and quite serious and more for grown-ups. And what we decided then is, okay, we need a new brand for all the commercial things we are doing, because it kind of diversified in a way, like it got more colorful and more funny and not so true to Polynoid. So we thought like, but we are still doing great work, so we'd love to show all that work. So that's when we founded Woodblock. This was in 2013. So this was before the dark times. Now that I'm that slide here, we've still been super happy there, and we thought like, cool, this whole commercial route and client route, that's definitely a fun way. But then after we did that kind of for a couple of years more, like I think around 2016 or something like that, there's really like where we've been so focused on making a living and growing our studio and keeping the team happy and everything, it's kind of we slowly discovered a frustration creeping in, and that we kind of completely lost our creative voice, right? We are coming from this, like making those short films that made us really happy, that really expressed what we wanted to express in the world. And now we are just executing their vision in a way, and we really started to struggle with this. And out of this struggle, I think our biggest transformation happened, and we kind of started to discover what we really want, right? And what is it we really want to do. And so, yeah, as I said, this is this frustration kind of led to a big moment of change and transformation for us, which didn't happen like one day after the other, right? It kind of frustration creeped in slowly, and also the transformation happened slowly. But what it was really about is that we kind of, we from that point of frustration, we started dreaming again, right? We started dreaming, what is it we really want to do? And what is it that makes us happy? And we discovered that we don't need to do anything like just to make money off it or to pay the bills, but that the best way to fulfill our dreams is to do what we really love to do. I think that was really the biggest thing that we lost on the years before. And in this whole phase of transformation, we started developing a lot of our own content. We're going to talk a bit more about that in a moment. We really started developing back or finding our ideas again of what we want to do. And it also came a lot with finding confidence again, and also finding confidence with our clients again, because we are, these days, we are still a service company. We are still doing a lot of client work, but we are coming from a completely different perspective now. It's like we are now at a place of full confidence, where we only take on projects that we really want to do, that we enjoy working on. And this is something that every client we get the feeling like everybody feels that, right? Like we are not only executing what somebody else was, we are giving them a vision and something we really want to create. And this is kind of the place where we're coming from now at the moment. So if we look at this a little bit more in terms of like specific, let's say, client relationships we have, like in the very beginning, when we started the studio, we have always been at the very end of the chain, right? So there is like in a classic client relationship, like there's the brand itself, right? Then there's the creative agency, then there's the production company, and then there is the animation house or the post-production house. And this has always been for us like a very frustrating like a place to be in, because like we had no direct connection to the people who actually bought our product in a way, right? And everybody in the chain like had something to say about things. And so yeah, this is something that we really wanted to change. And these days setup is completely different. Like most of the revenue we are making as a studio is now direct to brand. We have a handful of brands that we are working with constantly, some amazing brands. We're working constantly with Adidas, Swatch, Sky, and it's really enjoyable place to be in. And also, yeah, people and those brands, they work with us because they want to work with us, right? And not just because we offer a service that somebody else in the chain needs. And this kind of attitude is something that's really helping us to be in a place where we want to be. And so if we look a little bit more in detail, about what helped us to trigger this transformation, it is really the idea of getting back to creating what we want to create. And these days we call this IP, right? Intellectual property, as everybody know, or as many might know. And this is kind of what we are focusing a lot. It's still, I'm trying to be completely transparent and honest here. We are still, as a studio, making most of our money, or basically all of our money, with service work for clients. But the thing that changed is that we are basically investing all the money we are making, we are investing it back in creating our own IP. This can be many different things, this is a series we are developing, this is short films we are producing, this is films and movies we are developing, this is technology we are developing, our own pipeline tool that also Ivan and the Dutch guys are using that we are turning into a product. This is a advertisement product that go beyond film. So all this is what we call IP and what we develop. And the long-term plan here for us is to generate a second revenue stream where we get more and more independent from our pure commercial and service work. And I mean, it is a long way. I guess we already in 2018, I guess we already talked about it. It's now 4 years later, right? And it's still not like that we can say, yeah, we made it, we achieved this already. But even the act of doing it and creating what's important to us and what comes out of us is achieving many, many things. It's making all of us in the studio and also us of the founders, it's making us much happier and living a much more balanced life. And it's also making us much more creative. And we are all convinced that why we are putting so much energy investment behind it, that it will also lead to the way of true independence, which is what we are all after. And so a couple of words about our values that developed with this transformation that we've been going through, because it also helped us a lot to find what's really important to us, what is it that we really want to do in the world, what we want to bring to the world. And so I think one thing that for us as a studio is really at the center of what we are doing is sustainability. And we have not been so aware of this from the very beginning in terms of really speaking it out, because I think it's kind of something that has always been natural to us. But now, and kind of in the world we live in and everything that's happening, we can see that what we kind of found is that it's really important that we actively take part in trying to make this world a better place. And the best where we can start to do this is really in our own surrounding and in us and with our people, right? So meaning of sustainability here in that context is really that, first of all, of course, that we really care about our environment, that we very simple things, right? That we don't make waste, that or that we avoid waste where it's possible, that we only eat locally sourced food, that we don't travel unnecessary. That's also one of the main reasons why we are not in Belgrade this year, because we tried to connect it with other trips, but it didn't work. And just for a 2-day trip, we think it's really not worth spending that much energy on a flight. And so all those things are really important for us. But it's also on the other side, it's also sustainability with the team, right? As we all know, in the animation industry and especially in the VFX industry, long working hours is unfortunately still, let's say, more the norm. Everybody's burned out quickly and it's the artists are not really taken care of. And this is something that was super important for us from the very, very beginning, to really look at our team that they are happy, that they don't work too much and that they get their creative freedom and that they get to do what they want and what makes them happy. So this is for us is all also in the whole bigger topic of sustainability. And of course, coming back to the happiness factor and the creative fulfillment, right? This is also something that we are not only applying to us as the partners, but we are applying this to our whole team, right? So we really want everybody in the team to have a creative vision, right? And to have their own projects and passions they are working on. And we are really trying to support them wherever we can so that they feel like on a fulfilled creative journey. And yeah, maybe already coming a little bit to the end of the presentation, like really just summing up what Milisha, you opened with the question, like talking a little bit about change itself, right? Like we are talking a lot about transformation change here in the studio and how we can optimize and keep making things better, right? Which is also change by itself. And it is something, the more we know and the more people we are and the more we grow, we can very clearly see that change is very scary for many people, and that the natural like behavior for a human mind is to be scared of change, right? And to wish for that everything stays the same. And that's something that we try to kind of take a bit to the opposite, right? Like what we are trying to do here with our studio and also with the people is to really embrace the change, right? And really, like when we see something where we think like, hey, we are doing this for a very long time this way already, and then we try to question it and really see, okay, can we do this differently? What can we adjust here? And what we always learn from it is that it's always something good is coming out of it. We're always growing from it. We're always evolving, and it's always getting better. I mean, some of the simple examples, right? Like that I guess many in our history know is like we have traditionally been like a softy marsh XSI studio, right? Which we like back in the days thought is that one amazing tool, right? And we thought like this is really our superpower that we can do this and everything. And then when Autodesk killed the product, we've been like really scared of this change in a way, and we held back onto XSI for a bit too long. And but then at some point there was no way back, and we needed to decide on a new tool, right? So we went all in on Houdini. And this is kind of what keeps us, what the main tool that helps us to produce high quality animation these days, right? So this is this one change that helped us, but then it came even with the bigger thing, like where we said, okay, if this happened once to us, so maybe we need to look at it a little bit different and not stick to one tool too much, right? So what even came out of it, like the bigger thing, is that we as a studio back in the days, after switching to Houdini and learning it, like what we learned in the bigger picture from it is that we should actually open up our pipeline to every tool possible, right? Like, so the artists should choose which tool they feel comfortable in, and it's our task as a studio to integrate like those tools into our pipeline and make it possible that the artists can work with it. So if this is just a small example of all the positive things like that can come from change, and there's many, many more. So yeah, that's kind of the big learning we have, like that we always try to evolve, always try to transform. And I guess that's it for now in terms of transformation and change. I hope this was insightful for you guys. And if you have any questions, please always feel free to reach out. We are always happy to chat. And thanks again for having me.
Thank you, Ilija. I think you covered the entire arc of your personal journey, but also of studio and everyone at the studio, which in the meantime really grew as a big ship to navigate. So I wanted to just touch back on the latest developments and the projects that you are growing in-house. So going away from the commercial side of the business and going away from your individual works, how do you see the industry respond to that? Because I think that's an interesting area that everyone at the moment is trying to tap in. So how it's been for you now?
Yeah, it's a good question. Once again, I think the first thing we can say is that we expected it to be a little bit easier in terms of that we find successes in it. But we find it actually, it's a pretty long-term game we are in, because it's something that we once again completely need to make our name in, right? Basically the same journey we did with commercials is in the beginning, nobody trusts you, right? And then you work your way up, and then people start trusting you, and then you get more work. And we find it's kind of the same in this let's say content or IP business, however we want to call it, is that at the moment we are still no names, right? None of us is a successful producer yet in terms of content. None of us is a successful director there yet. So if we go to the big buyers, the big streamers, and present our ideas to them, we are not immediately taken serious, right? So we need to work hard for it. But what we can already see is that we the more we do and the longer we work on it, the more serious they take us, right? So it's a game where we need to do everything in parallel. First of all, we need to kind of create the right setup in a way, the right team that they take serious, so it's creatively interesting enough for them. Then also creating the right concept, learning what they are really after. And I think once we get to that sweet spot, and if we keep refining and getting right there, then I guess at some point we will have our first success with it. And then from there, it will once again be a bit more easy, and the next one will work. So yeah, but it's, as in summary, it's a long way, but also a very enjoyable one. So we have no intention of stopping there yet.
Yeah, and I'm sure that once you, as you nailed the relationship with clients and managed to go up the ladder of the marketing business, I'm sure that you will be equally successful with big streamers and production companies that commission animated work. And before we let you go, I just wanted also to touch base on your showreel, because I think, in my personal opinion, the choice of music that you put when compiling a showreel is something that is unusual, so to say, and it also says a lot about your creative impulses when it comes to music. And we always talk about music and animation having this great bond. So how music is important in these elements, putting the showreel, does it have any creative factor when you develop your own work?
This one with the showreel, I really love it, this music, because it kind of mirrors our attitude at the moment very well, right? So we are very happy with that. It was interestingly that when we first picked the song, and showed it to the first guys here, everybody said, no, this is too crazy. But then we always got back to it, because we already fell in love with it. So yeah, we're really happy with it now. In terms of creating our in terms of music on our own shows and our own concepts, it is still we are coming from this place where audio was always a very important factor in the short films we did, right? And with most of the concepts we are developing, it is still the same. The new short film we are working on, it's going to be a new Polynaut short film. Obviously, the whole audio aspect is something incredibly important there. And there's a couple of shows where audio plays a huge part. There is others where we have not put such specific emphasis on the audio itself, because the shows are quite general, but it really it depends on the concept. But in general, yeah, audio always plays such a huge part. Completely agree with you.
Yeah, I think it very well conceptualize everything that you do. If you can reveal, is there any title or type of project under the Woodblock name that our audience and us should be expecting in the next year or so? Like, what is the one project that you think will see the big screens first?
So there is one that we've been working on a while already, and I think the title is out already, so I hope it's okay if I say it. So this one is called By Bear, and it's gonna be, as I said, like it's gonna be the next Polynoid short film. It's and it's gonna be very beautiful. So it's exactly as you said. We hope to release it at some point during the next year. Those short films, they always take particularly long to finish because, as we said in the beginning, right, it's almost impossible to make any money from short films. So yeah, but it's a labor of love. It's a very strong story. So I think this is the first one that's going to see the light of the day.
We hope, and actually I can make a promise now that we will use that opportunity to bring you back in person in Belgrade in some of the next CGA editions.
That sounds wonderful.
Thank you so much. And I think that's where we wrap our session and go back to prepare for the next one.